The reason for BBC Two's change of schedule this afternoon is to bring you coverage of the racing from Ascot, postponed because of the weather. It's introduced now by Richard Pittman.
Welcome to Ascot, and a very happy St. Valentine's Day to you. Well, today's race meeting, I'm glad it's been saved. It was originally scheduled for last Wednesday, but amazing what difference a week makes, isn't it? I mean, the whole place was snowed under a week ago. Happily, we've saved it because there is some tremendous racing in store. This is what we've got lined up for you. Now, Sound Man is the star horse on show today. Edward O'Grady's brought him over from Ireland, and he bids for his fifth win in a row. He's very good. Squire Silk is the winner of the Tote Gold Trophy last Saturday. We'll show you that again, and also the fall of Eskimo Nell. Imperial Call, smashing horse, gone straight up into the big league after his win in Ireland. Lorcan Wire gets down to grips here with a horse that can't buck, but it'll keep all the boys at Newbury fit to fight. So, all that to come up later in the programme. I'm pleased to say with me now is Norman Williamson, though he won't be very pleased to be here. Norman, what an amazing game this is. I mean, you'd been out with a broken leg, you came back, second ride, Eskimo Nell, shoulder. What's the state of play now?
The shoulder went back in quite quickly on Saturday evening, so I'm really giving it a go. I'm doing some exercise with Mary Bromley and Rabbit Slattery, and they've put me on a fitness program, which isn't very nice, having to get up and do a bit of work, but I'm hopeful that in 2 weeks I might get the all clear to come back and even start riding out. And it's fingers crossed for Cheltenham, we don't really know yet, but, you know, 10 days from now and we'll have a fair idea.
Okay, well, stick with us because we've got plenty of work for Norman to do during the afternoon. Well, he's not the only man in the wars, and much more serious, of course, is Walter Swinburne, who had a terrible fall in Hong Kong. I've been in touch with them, and I'll update you with that. But let's remind ourselves of what actually happened with Liffey River. This is an amazing horse. He's on the right of the picture. There he goes out of the picture as he dives left-handed. Walter straightens him, and he comes flying across the course. You'd think he'd follow the other horses. No, straight into the rails, and he swings Walter over and into the bottom of the railings there, where there are metal posts, obviously holding him in. Now, why would a horse do this, Norman?
It's amazing, really. I think it's just a two-year-old having his first run in a pair of blinkers, but I've never seen a horse to go across the opposite way so quick. You can see Walter pulled his stick through and tried to straighten, and I'd say at the time he probably thought it would follow the other horses. The rail broke his fall, but obviously it didn't break it enough.
Well, plastic railings, of course, are a big improvement, but they do need the metal bit to hold them up. Well, Walter Swinburne, we've been in touch, and the family do want to make it known that he didn't have fluid drained from his brain. He does have an injury to the head there, but they took fluid off his lungs, so they want that put straight. And he's still under sedation, that's getting less, and they're taking him off the ventilator today, so it all looks as if things are getting better for Walter. But I'm afraid it'll be a long haul back to health, but we wish him luck, as I'm sure you do too. Well, what have we got in store for you today? Some smashing racing. The menu for today is as follows: the Shenley Enterprise Hurdle. This is a limited handicap over 3 miles. Hebridean coming back after falling a couple of times over fences. The Comet Chase, not many runners here, but Sound Man is the star on show there from Edward O'Grady's yard, 2 miles 3. And then the Reynoldstown, well, we've got 4 top novices here who are all bidding to put their reputations right on the line, and of course whoever wins this will be favourite for the Sun Alliance, I'm sure. Well, the going is officially good to soft in places. The jockeys report that it's dead and tacky. Now, there's one non-runner later today, not in any of the televised races. It's in the 435, and this is Jim Old's horse, number 18, in the bumper. It's called Wise King. Well, we've already had three races this afternoon. I'm sure you want to see them. I won't spoil them for you at all if you haven't seen the result. So let's take a betting check on the first, which was the conditional jockeys race. The Twist and Davis horse, exterior profiles at fives, old habits eights, the same price, Blue Laws. Landed Gentry was 9-1 on the drift there, Arctic Life at tens, the same price, Ballerica, and Tartan Moss the same. It was 12-1 bar those. We can join it with Jim McGrath with two hurdles to go.
Up towards the home turn, two flights to jump in the home straight now. Brambleberry gone in the stride, another grey though in front. It's Can Can Charlie who shows the way. Two lengths to Landed Gentry, Lively Night, Lux Brannigan still battling on the outside. They're nicely clear of Bayer, Riker, Arctic Life, Brambleberry, and further back is Harding. On the corner now, they've got two flights left to jump in the home straight, and Can Can Charlie. Four lengths in front here of Landed Gentry, who's giving chase. Then Lively Night, followed by on the outside, Lux Brannigan, coming up towards the second last. They're very weary. Can Can Charlie, three in front as he draws towards it now. Takes off, met it awkwardly. Landed Gentry steadily making ground. Then Bayer Riker running on well from Lux Brannigan. Harding's got a second wind the far side. At the last, Landed Gentry takes it up now. Goes two in front. Lands okay from Can Can Charlie. Then Harding the far side from Bayer Riker. Further back, Lux Brannigan. It's Landed Gentry, two in front of Can Can Charlie and Harding with 100 yards left to go. And Landed Gentry pushed right out is going to get the money. Landed Gentry going on to score here by three or four lengths. Harding will get up for second. A gap to Bayer Riker third, followed by Can Can Charlie fourth.
Starting prices for the first. Number one, Landed Gentry at 9-1 was the winner. 10, Harding was second at 20, 2-0-1. The third horse into number 12, Bayer Riker at 10s. And the fourth, number 9, Can Can Charlie at 14-1. Now, their second race was a cracker. This was had several champion hurdle horses in it. Borrow 8, the former Irish horse, was favoured at 3s, having drifted from 9-4. Oh So Risky in at 100-30. 14-year-old Moldboard, well, he drifted. He was friendless, 9-4 out to 7-2. The same price, Absalom's Lady the Grey, and Lucky Blue was 6-1, having opened at 8. Again, we can join this with commentator Jim McGrath.
15 lengths tailed off. Heading up towards the home turn now, two to jump in the straight, and Lucky Blue on the left of picture from Absalom's Lady. Moldboard in behind them, and Borrowaid moving up on his outside to try and keep him in a pocket as this quartet round the home turn now with two to jump. Lucky Blue the far side, and neck in front of Absalom's Lady being ridden along now, going a bit wide. Borrowaid there in the centre. Moldboard's got plenty of room now in the centre as well as they range up now towards the second last flight. Lucky Blue still there, has run a great race, but here's Moldboard called on for his effort, followed by Absalom's Lady. They've left Borrowaid behind as they clear the second last. Absalom's Lady jumped at the best, lands about a neck in front here of Moldboard and Lucky Blue, followed by Borrowaid. They race up now towards the last. Moldboard in the centre, tackled again now by Absalom's Lady, the near side. They clear then of Lucky Blue and Borrowaid. It's Moldboard the far side, the near side is Absalom's Lady. Moldboard digging deep, a length and a half, two lengths in front, and now starting to power clear. Moldboard going on to win the levee board hurdle in good style. It's Moldboard pushed out the win by three lengths. Second Absalom's Lady. Borrowaid got up for third, followed by Lucky Blue, and looking down the track, Oh So Risky has been pulled up.
What a marvellous win there for Jim Old's Moldboard. 7-2, the winner. Second, number 3, the Grey Absalom's Lady at 7-2. And third, number 1, Borrow 8, the 3-1 favourite. News of Oh So Risky, who pulled up there, the stewards inquired, and David Ellsworth said the horse broke a blood vessel. Well, shortly afterwards, Jonathan Powell caught up with Moldboard's trainer, Jim Old, and he spoke to him in the winner's enclosure.
Jim, this old horse got a tremendous reception when he came back. Here he is at 14. Has he got a serious chance in your mind in the champion hurdle?
All right, Jamie just said stay as hurdle. So that's we'll forgo the chance and give him his chance to go 3 miles, which I've never been convinced he really gets. But he's older now, he settles. No, I'm not going to say he's more sensible because he is. I don't know, we'll wait and see. I think if he hasn't won a champion hurdle by now, it probably ought to give him a chance to go for the stayers, you know.
And Jim, how long have you trained this horse?
I've forgotten. My back's very, very sore from riding him. I don't know, 7 years or so.
And you have a great affinity with these old horses because you keep them for so long. Have you ever had one at 14 who still has this sort of ability?
Seema got beat at Leicester, age 14, with 12 stone on his back, got beat a short head. And Joint Venture and Wing Dagger were both placed several times at 14, didn't win. So he's beaten them, you know. But they'd had, actually, Joint Venture, Wing Dagger and Seymour had had just under 100 races each. And 97, 98, 96 or something. He hasn't had that many races, so perhaps he's a bit fresher.
And what is the key to your affinity with these horses? Other people tend to retire them much earlier. I know he hasn't got a lot of mileage on the clock, but why do you seem to bring out the best in these veterans?
Well, I don't know whether I do, really. I've perhaps been lucky to have a few tough old buggers, but I think I don't abuse them when the conditions are wrong. I think that's a big thing. I mean, if we'd gone to Cheltenham with him on two different occasions when the ground was firm, he wouldn't be here now. He'd have been long gone, wouldn't he, you know? And at the time, I mean, it's a hard decision to make, and but when you're standing here now, you think, well, perhaps it's worth it.
Yes, it's worth it, all right. But isn't it a marvellous game, this jumping game? A horse is going as long as that mouldboard. I'm sure you at home feel that you know him and probably take a great interest in him, almost feel you own a bit of him. Right, the 2 o'clock was an interesting one. It was a novice chase. We'll take a check on the betting. Super Coin was 15-8, clear favourite there. Three's Numero, the same price Lord Dorset. 6.5-1 Pimberley Place. Fierce was 10s, having drifted. 40's Ballat and Tango's Delight. No one wanted him at 66-1. It was a novice chase. Let's join them. They're all on their feet.
Place in a gap to Ballat, heading around the home turn, two fences in the home straight to be jumped, and Fierce has made every yard, but here come the challengers on the outside. Super Coin in the centre, near side is Lord Dorset, and Pimberley placed behind them. At the second last, Fierce being tackled now by Super Coin, who put in a mighty leap. On the near side, Lord Dorset ranging up as well, three in line as they charge towards the last, and they're clear of Pimberley Place. Heading up towards the last, Lord Dorset on the near side ranges up now to throw out the challenge to Super Coin. It's Lord Dorset going the better as they come to the last, jumps it well, lands full of running, two lengths in front of Super Coin. Pimberley Place is running on well from Fierce, but pushed out hands and heels in the run to the line. It's Lord Dorset who's going to go on and score by the best part of two or three lengths. In second placing Pimberley Place, third then Super Coin, a gap to Fierce in fourth.
Yes, a good race that. Lord Dorset the winner at 3-1. Pimberley Place running on strongly second at 13-2. Super Coin was third, 15-8 favourite. Well, the race is a lot of prize money on offer, and there's also been a fair bit of activity in the market, and there's no one better to tell you about this than our betting guru, Graham Rock.
Well, Graham, wasn't it marvellous this meeting has been saved?
Absolutely, and the Reynoldstown Chase is like a mini Sun Alliance, isn't it? It's the best novice chase of the season. And this morning there was a wide divergence of opinion amongst bookmakers. Labrus went 6-4 St Millian Fairway. Other bookmakers were going 3-1, 100-30. So for once, punters had a real choice. Now, as you'd expect, with 130 St Millian Fairway, that's been clipped to 5-2. Mr Mulligan, 100-30, some enormous bets for him. Labrus report a 2,000 crown cash bet in their betting shops. Victor Chandler laid a 20,000 to 6,000 to a credit client. And Hills, they £10,090 to win, tax paid, to a cash punter in one of theirs. I don't quite know where he's got that from. Probably having to put on for some for his mates as well. So, you know, with this, as I say, vast divergence in prices, Nathan Ladd's into 7-2, Major Summits into 6-1 from 8, and even Bond Jr., some very, very shrewd judges have been on that one each way. But I think it'll be tight at the end between St Millian Fairway, probably just favourite, ahead of Mr Mulligan.
Okay. Well, what about the Comet? I suppose, isn't really a betting race, is it?
Well, particularly the comments in the paper this morning from Eddie O'Grady saying Sal Maddy left a bit to work on for Cheltenham. You're not going to lay 2-1 on to a lot of money about a horse like that, even though he does appear to be a cut above them on paper. 1-2 Sal Man, 7-2 Coulton, 6 Storm Alert, not much interest. Punters who want to lay the odds will surely come to Ascot to avoid paying tax.
And the hurdle race, the first one we'll see, a three-miler.
Yes, wide open here, as you can see, and I should say, of the best back there, Angelo's Double was 6-1 originally, now into 9-2 with Ladbrokes, but as you can see from those prices, pretty wide open and a hard race in which to pick the winner.
So, fascinating that to St Millian's Fairway, the cash around for that, isn't it?
Well, as I say, one bookmaker going 6-4 and another one more than twice the odds. I mean, usually they all follow each other pretty regularly, but you know, it gave punters a real chance to state their own view, to shop around, and, you know, jolly good, let's have a bit more of it.
Right, 10,090p, that's marvellous, isn't it, paying the tax on. Okay, well, we can move on to our first live race and we can get the runners and riders for the 2:30 from Jim McGrath.
Thank you, Richard. The third event, the Shenley Enterprises Hurdle,
limited handicap over 3 miles. Number one is Hebridean, Adrian Maguire. Two, Time for a Run, Richard Dunwoody. Number three is Simpson, Tom Grantham. Four, Seekin Cash, Jamie Osborne. Number five is Balasani, Jonathan Lower, the rider now. Mark Pirrott, the usual pilot, now retired. Number six is Top Spin, Paul Carey. Seven is Gillen Cove, Tony McCoy. Number eight is Island Jewel, Mick Fitzgerald. Number nine, Pregada, Philip Hyde. 10 is Buckhouse Boy, Carl Llewellyn. 11, Angelo's Double, Brendan Powell. Number 12, Clifton Set, Jamie Railton. 13, Brindley House, David Bowen, claiming the 7. And 14 is Star Oats, Guy Lewis, claiming 3. Now, 8 of the 14 in this event hold entries in the Stayers Hurdle, the 3-mile Stayers Hurdle at Cheltenham. Betting as follows.
And 4-1 the field, Buckhouse Boy is the favourite, having opened at 7-2. Then it's 5-1 Time for a Run, 5-1 Angelo's Double, 6-1 Hebridean, 7 Simpson just drifting out there, 12 Seeking Cash and Balasani, 14-1 Top Spin, Gillen Cove and Island Jewel. Then it goes 16-1 Pregada, 20-1 Clifton Set, and the outsiders Brindley House and Star Oats, both 100-1.
And the first horse we see in the middle of your picture is the shape of Time for a Run, the emerald green and orange hooped mount of Richard Dunwoody, riding the Irish Raider. Richard's been across to Ireland to ride a lot of horses this season. What sort of chance do you give this, Norman?
I think he's a very good hurdler. He's ran well around Cheltenham, he's won around Cheltenham, and he ran well in the handicap with Top Weight there last year. He's been running over fences, and I watched him a couple of times. He just jumped a bit left and probably a bit big, and the time looked a bit cowardly. But if he comes back to his best, I think he could take all the beating, yeah.
He's 9 years of age now. It sometimes takes these horses a bit of time to go and jump fences, especially when they're getting on a little bit, isn't it?
It does, but this fella, I think, could go back over fences, but obviously they're hoping to win here today and go for a handicap order probably at Cheltenham.
Here's another horse doing the same there, the mount of Adrian Maguire, trained by the champion trainer David Nicholson, Hebridean. I saw him win his first race over fences at Worcester. Jumped okay after that. He didn't look as if he liked it too much at all. Very, very good horse on his day. Love the grounds. It just will, coming back to hurdles, make any difference to him.
Again, he's much the same. He obviously didn't enjoy his couple of falls over fences, but he's won the long walk hurdle here last year, and that time he looked like he'd go on to win a staying hurdle. He can be a very good horse in his day, but again, he's back to hurdles, and hopefully the fences didn't frighten him too much.
The ground's going to be fairly testing out there. They're going to want to stay the trip all the way.
Yes, I think a lot of these horses probably do get the trip quite well. Time for a Run, you know, he hasn't won over 3 miles, but he's proved 2-5 round Cheltenham, no problem in soft ground, so hopefully he should be okay.
Horse in our picture now is Buckhouse Boy with a red cap and the spots just walking away. He's still a novice, this horse, although he did run over hurdles last year. He's taken his time to come to himself. He's £9 out of the handicap. He's a young horse with a big future in front of him and an improving type.
Yes, Skew, I'm sure you'll know more about this fella than I do, but obviously he's out of the handicap, it won't help him here, but you never know what these improving novices could take all the beating.
His form looks pretty good, close to, he was second to Far and Near at Chepstow. Far and Near went on and won a handicap at Warwick. This horse has won a handicap at Warwick as well.
Do you think the ground will be any problem, Skew?
No, I think he'll handle the ground fairly well. He was second on the ground at Chepstow. He's one of those extraordinary horses that does tend to get in a little bit of trouble sometimes through his races. So let's just hope that Carl can steer a clear course on him.
I'm sure they'll go a good enough gallop and they'll probably be strung out after jumping two or three.
It's a good track to ride around here, isn't it? Especially over hurdles.
Yes, and they always seem to go a good gallop, especially from the start. They go downhill over the first two hurdles, and you always seem to be able to get a bit of light, even if it's down the inner. You don't have a rail all the way around, and it's not a problem. He's going down well, Skew.
He's moving well. There's one of the old stalwarts of the wearing room, not the horse, but the jockey, Brendan Powell, with the pink colours, with the stars on. Angelo's Double. Brendan got a little bit of stick for his riding of this horse at Warwick. Obviously he's got to be held up till late, then came and won at Kempton, being held up late. Again, a horse with a chance.
Yeah, a horse with a good chance again, but again, you know, has to run out of the handicap. But hopefully the trip today, the trip in Warwick was sharper than this, and if it has to be held up, he just might come through when the others are getting tired. Brendan is riding as well as ever, isn't he?
It's all about confidence, though, isn't it? I listened to other sports, listened to the cricket today about some of the batsmen needing to get into form and confidence. And when things are going well for you, make the right decisions, and when things are going wrong, you make the wrong decisions.
Yes, I always feel, especially around this time last year, I was having a great run, and I always feel you can just stand up on a horse and hack away around as if there's no race on, and I definitely think it translates to the horse, and you could improve a horse 7 pounds, I think.
And there are the green and white diamonds, just the far side of Brendan Powell. There's number three, that's Simpson, mount of Tom Grantham. This horse is another of Jim Old stalwarts, 11 years of age, and another horse that'll love the ground.
He is, he's a very tough horse, and he always runs a big race. Whether he's up to this class is another thing. He always seems to be there or thereabouts. I just find it hard to see him going and winning.
Yes, Jim's horses sometimes take a little bit of time to come to himself. I walked around his stable early in the season, and he did feel that this horse was up to staying hurdle class, so we'll have to see. He's a horse that you will know well, the mount of Jamie Osborne, Seeking Cash. I remember this horse when Charlie Edgerton had him. I think he's the most magnificent looking horse. He's a flat race bred horse, but he looked like a horse that was going to right to the top and then got a little bit of leg trouble. Now he's with your trainer, Kim Bailey.
Yes, Hugh, he is a wonderful looking horse. When he was with Charlie Edgerton, he was a top class novice. At the time, I think he was the only novice to beat Rel Keel. And then he went on, and they thought he was so good, they ran him in the stairs hurdle at Cheltenham. He ran bad, and he then had 12 months off. Now he's with Mr. Bailey. I actually haven't sat on the horse. I've been out all season and have never got to ride him. But I watched him school the other day, and he jumped really well. He's so big, he can be a bit awkward at one or two hurdles. But he didn't run a great race in Haydock on his reappearance, but hopefully he can put that behind him. There was a lot of Mr. Bailey's horses wrong at the time, so hopefully they're definitely hoping for a big run today. Had a funny one. I spoke to his lad last night, and he said, if he wins, I'll be the only man to ever cry on television, so let's hope he wins for it.
Here's a horse that's got to be held right up to the last, the former winner of the Stayers Hurdle. He got an objection from Avro Anson, but he's a very, very good horse. Never my type of ride. I was always trying to hit the front too soon on him, but hasn't been showing his form lately. The ride of Mark Perrott, as Jim McGrath pointed out, got the able talents of Jonathan Lauer on his back, would have a chance at his best.
Yes, this horse. I'd probably miss Mark Perrott today. He hasn't, but we wish Mark well anyway on his retirement.
Did you ride him? John Jenkins had him at one time. Did you ever ride him there?
No, I've never ridden him.
Number six there is the John Jenkins trained Top Spin, mount of Paul Carberry. Paul's made a big impression since coming over here. They look as if they're going to line up. And I will let Jim take you through the race.
Thanks, Scoo. The runners now coming in over there on the far side of the course. Started just holding them. They'll jump two before they reach Swindley Bottom the first time. And the one that's turned the wrong way is Island Jewel, Simpson, just edging a bit closer on the near side of the diamonds. Another one of the veterans trained by Jim Old. Bellassani right there, number five in the centre of the screen there. Buckhouse Boy, the 9-2 favourite. Time for a run at fives. Money for Seeking Cash there in 10-1 now from 14s. And away they go in this Shenley Enterprises hurdle over 3 miles. And Island Jewel, the first one to step off. Up there as well too is Seeking Cash in the early stages. Pragada is there as well as they come to the first now. And just hitting that hard with Star Oats, just dropped back a place or two. But Seeking Cash on settling down by three parts of a length to Pragada in second, a length away then moving up on the inside, Star Oats into third. Island Jewel is wide around as they head over the second. Star Oats is not jumping at all well. Further back in the field then at this stage we see Simpson being ridden along as they race into Swindley Bottom the first time. Time for a run is well back in the field in company there with Top Spin. Then on the outside is Hebridean. But the leader is Seeking Cash by about a neck or so to Brigada the outside as they race out of Swindley Bottom now. And they're a length and a half clear as they are about to swing right-handed up the side of the course. Island Jewel in third place in Clifton set as wider out. Then in the centre is Star Oats at this stage, followed next in the field by Brindley House with the orange blinkers. They're followed next in the field by Seek and Cash, followed by Hebridean, and further back is Gill and Cove. They're followed by Buckhouse Boy as they head over flight number three. They're further back in the field is Simpson. Belisani is right out the back at this stage as they head up now towards the next flight. Pregada it is who shows the way from Clifton Seth, the outside. They're two lengths in advance now of with the noseband we see on the left of picture, Seek and Cash, followed then by Star Oates, who's right there in the center. Island Jewel behind them, followed on the outside by Brindley House. Then follows in the center, Gillen Cove. Buckhouse Boy is right there on the inside of runners, two lengths to Hebridean. Followed next then by, on the inside, Simpson. Further back in the field is Angelo's Double From, Time for a Run. Half a length away then, Top Spin the outside and two lengths to Belisani. They've got 2 miles left to travel as they head up the straight the first time and towards flight number five. And the leader in the centre is Pregada from Clifton Set, the near side. Seek and Cash is over on the far side. Pregada put in a good leap there. Brindley House behind them. There's a faller back in the field there. The one that's gone is Simpson. Simpson has come to grief there as they head up now towards the next. And Pregada it is who shows the way from Seek and Cash and Clifton Set, the near side. Two lengths away, Island Jewel, followed by Buckhouse Boy and Gillen Cove in the center. On the near side next is Star Oates in the striped jacket. Further back, Buckhouse Boy getting closer over on that far side. Angelo's Double is next in the field and company there in the center with Hebridean, then dropping back Brindley House. Time for a Run taking closer order from Belisani and Top Spin as they pass the judge. And the riderless Simpson seems to be okay as they pass the judge now, and a race down the side of the course. Three flights awaiting them down there, and Pregada it is who shows the way. The blinkered Pregada, a veteran, leads by a length to Clifton Set, a half length away Seek and Cash with a purple cap the near side from Island Jewel, and further back then on the outside Gillen Cove with the white armlets. Buckhouse Boy with a red cap the near side, followed next in the field by Time for a Run. Hebridean is wider out from Belisani, back in the field with a red cap, green hoop sleeves, and Top Spin the black cap is over on the far side. Heading towards the first of three down the side, and Pregada cleared it in the lead there by half a length of Island Jewel, then out wider Clifton Set. On the near side, Seek and Cash is up there in fourth position with the noseband on the near side. Gillen Cove, number seven, over on the far side, followed by Buckhouse Boy. Further back there on the near side is Time for a Run from Hebridean as they continue their journey down the far side of the course towards flight number nine. Pregada still showing the way gamely by half a length of Island Set, Island Jewel, I should say. Out wider then is Clifton Set, followed then on the near side next by Seek and Cash. Then Angelo's Double, who's starting to work into the picture now. From Hebridean, Gillen Cove's under the whip. Buckhouse Boy about three or four lengths off the pace. Two lengths away is Time for a Run as they race into Swinley Bottom now and up the side of the course. And on the near side, Pregada being tackled now by Clifton Set, the purple cap, the far side. A length to Angelo's Double looming up in the pink. Followed next in the field by Island Jewel. Then on the near side is Seek and Cash as they race out of Swinley Bottom now and head up towards four out. Top Spin's getting reminders. In behind the leaders, Buckhouse Boy going okay, and Time for a Run is further back from Belisani. Up the side of the course now towards four out, and Angelo's Double on the right of picture has loomed up now in company with Clifton Set to take over. Pregada's given ground. In behind them is Seek and Cash on the left of picture, followed by Buckhouse Boy. Island Jewel is next as they head up towards the third last. Seek and Cash it is who jumps up on the near side to tackle this leader, Angelo's Double. Clifton Set behind them is all out, followed by Gillen Cove. They're two or three lengths. Pregada next in the field then is Island Jewel in the center from Time for a Run, and further back in the field is Hebridean heading up towards the home turn now. They've got two flights to jump in the straight, and Angelo's Double the near side, the far side, the noseband there of Seek and Cash. Three lengths to Clifton Set as they round the corner now, followed by Gillen Cove, and they're nicely clear as they head up for the judge now. Two flights in the home straight to jump. Seek and Cash, the noseband, the far side, Angelo's Double the near side. They're three or four lengths in advance now of Clifton Set as they head up towards the second last from Gillen Cove, and further back is Time for a Run. Heading towards the second last on the far side, Seek and Cash jumps at three lengths in front of Angelo's Double, who can't find much more. Further back is Gillen Cove from Clifton Set, and they were followed by Time for a Run. At the last, though, it's Seek and Cash, who clears it well, did it in great style too, jumps at about six or seven in front, going further ahead, and Seek and Cash, confidently ridden by Jamie Osborne, is coming away here to win by a street. Lee's down on the line. It's Seek and Cash will go on to score by the best part of 15 lengths. Gillen Cove is going to get second, Angelo's Double third,
followed then by Buckhouse Boy in fourth, a gap to Clifton, set time for a run, then Top Spin from Pregada Bellassani, and they are the only finishers. Looking back down the track, both the Brindley House and Star Oats have both been pulled up. The winner of the Shenley Enterprises Hurdle, a limited handicap over 3 miles, first number four, Seeking Cash, ridden by Jamie Osborne. A double for him today, his 42nd winner of the season. He was successful earlier on Moldboard. Owned Seeking Cash by Mrs. David Thompson, trained by Kim Bailey, and ridden by Jamie Osborne. Second number seven, Gillen Cove, raced by Forum Racing, trained by Robert Olner and ridden by Tony McCoy. And third number 11, Angelo's Double, owned by Jay Henwood, ridden by, I should say, trained by Bob Bucklow and ridden by Brendan Powell. And fourth number 10, Buckhouse Boy. But Seeking Cash was very confidently ridden by Jamie Osborne throughout, was sitting up there just behind them, always had the leaders in his sights, and hasn't he run on well?
Yes, I've got a jockey here who will be very much looking forward to getting back on this horse. Norman quite rightly pointed out what a good horse he was before and said he was right back to his best. And here as he turns into the straight, he's jumped fairly well, Norman. As you say, for a big horse, he can be a little bit clumsy now and again, but here he's got the race pretty much sewn up.
He really has. Jeremy down the inner on him all the way, quite handy. Got close to a couple of hurdles down the back, but really, out of Swindley bottom, he was always travelling better than anything. And these last two hurdles, he's picked up and pinged. A very good performance, and he looks a very decent horse in the making, doesn't he?
He does, and he'll be set sail for the stairs. He looked to do a lot of his winning on better ground than this earlier in his career.
Yes, I spoke to Mr. Bailey before racing, and he was just a little bit worried about him and the trip. He thought he might be better over 2.5 going a good gallop, but obviously with a lead today didn't make any difference, and you can't say he doesn't get the trip the way he won today. He's absolutely bolted it.
He looks a very good class horse. Gillen Cove ran on to be a good race for second. Angela's Double was third, was right up there a little bit more than usual, but just faded in the last bit there. Can we see the stable lad crying there?
I doubt he's crying. He's probably got a few pounds for himself, I'd say. By the way, he was talking last night. He always rides about himself at home, so he'd be very pleased.
We can hand to Graham and the SBs.
And Seeking Cash, the winner there at 10-1. An on-course gamble from 14-1. Second number 7, Gillen Cove, 14-1. And third number 11, Angelo's Double at 5-1. And the totes there win £9.30, places £3.10, £4.30 and £1.70. The dual forecast £48.70, straight forecast £127.98. And the tricast £715.32.
Yes, listening to the SP with great interest there was the horse's trainer, Kim Bailey. Kim, this horse has had a lot of problems, but he certainly has put them behind him now.
He has. He pulled away, actually ran disappointingly, most probably in a stayers hurdle. He's had a bit of a leg problem since. He's had a year off, and we were disappointed where he ran at Haydock, but he's obviously very ring rusty. He's come on a lot for that. It was a good performance today.
And is the stayers hurdle the target at this stage?
Yes, it always has been his target for the season, and obviously that'll be his next race.
He was a very, very good novice, what, two or three seasons ago?
Yeah, so you've got to remember he beat David Nicholson's champion hurdle horse in the Sydney Banks hurdle at Huntingdon. That was 2.5 miles, and the horse does stay forever. So, I mean, Cheltenham's got always been his aim and will be obviously his aim again.
And just looking at him here, you could see him jumping fences perhaps next season.
I would hope so, yes. I mean, Charlie Edson, who had him before, did a wonderful job on him, and he always was slightly worried about the way he jumps. I mean, he's very good on a long stride. He's not great when he comes in short. And that's one of the reasons why he just stayed hurdles this season, is to give him a bit more experience.
Would you give him another run yet before Cheltenham?
I think most probably unlikely. It's hard to find races for him between now and Cheltenham. So I think, well, I suppose there's a race at Kempton next weekend. We might think about that. But, you know, everything's geared up for Cheltenham.
You've got your jockey Norman Williamson helping out on the BBC today. He's sounding very bullish now about Cheltenham. He's certainly looking in good shape here. How hopeful are you that he will be fit to ride before the festival?
Well, I'd obviously want him to ride before the festival. It's important for me that he does come back to ride the festival meeting. I mean, he's a stable jockey, he knows all the horses, and having to mess around with different jockeys the whole time makes life pretty hard work. His treatment's going well. I hope that in 10 days' time he'll start riding out and have a good week's riding before he actually hits the festival.
And the big riding engagement for the moment on your mind, of course, is Alderbrook next week at Wincanton. Do you know yet who's going to ride him?
I haven't made a decision yet. I have to wait to see what Richard Dunwood is doing after the weekend. But I imagine it'll either be Jamie Osborne or possibly Graham Bradley. Jamie Osborne sat on the horse and schooled him this week and schools him again on Sunday. But I want to see what Norman's up to see if I have the same pilot for the two races. but if Norman's available for Cheltenham, he'll ride him, so therefore Jamie will most probably ride him next week. But if for some extraordinary reason it looks unlikely that Norman will ride, then I have to think about someone else who will ride him on both occasions.
And the horse is in good shape?
I'm very pleased with him, yes, he's in good nick.
Kim, thank you very much.
Pleasure, thank you.
And results from elsewhere this afternoon. Let's begin at Lingfield with the 145. And the first horse there, number 12, Escarta Fig at 7-4 joint favourite. Second, number 1, Flight Lieutenant, 11-2. And third, number 5, Lord McMurrah at 20-1. Totes their win, £3.10. Places £1.10, £1.90, £5.30. The dual forecast, £12.10. And the straight forecast, £11.94. Non-runner, number 8. The 220 there. First number 9, Superior Risk, the 15-8 joint favourite. Second number 3, Belly Boy, 15-8 joint favourite. And third number 8, Sheriff Muir, 20-1. Totes win £2.70. Places £2.80, £1.10 and £5. Dual forecast £3.10. Straight forecast £5.81. Non-runner number 4. And up at Sedgefield in the 135. First number 2, Cumbrian Rhapsody, 3-1 joint favourite. Second number 5, Basson Halley, 11-2. Third number 8, Maryhill Gold at 20-1. Win there £5.30, places £2.10, £1.90 and £4.60. The dual forecast £7.80. Straight forecast £22.99. And the tricast £2.86.38. That's all 13 ran. Sedgefield 2-10, first number 9 star performer, the 2-1 joint to 2-1 clear favourite. Second number 16, keen to the last at 9-4. Third number 18, Our Rainbow 10-1. They win their 350, places 180, 130, 280. Dual forecast £3.60, straight forecast £7.71.
Well, only last week Newbury introduced a new riding aid for the jockeys, and we sent Peter Skew to investigate.
Jockeys' finishing styles are governed by their size and strength, but until now there has been little opportunity to refine that style other than on the back of a horse. Last Saturday, Newbury introduced a new mount that nobody would be paid to ride, but everybody wanted to sit on, the Rideaway.
Perhaps you've wondered how the jockeys warm up for a race, but here's a mechanical horse, and Lorcanwire is going to give us an indication of how he warms up for a race.
Okay, well, just imagine, Skew, we're just jumping the last hurdle now. We're heading for the winning line. We just touched down over the last. We're grabbing a shorter hold of the horse. We just give him a backhander just to keep his mind on the job. We're really going for it now. We're upsized, we see the line in view, and we're really giving it a rock on. And we've probably just got up and won a short head and got a four-day back into the bargain.
Well, the flat race jockey Richard Perham's invented this, or just redesigned this. Do you think it's a good idea?
This is my first time to have ever been associated with anything like this. I think it surely must be a great thing both to keep fit and to improve your style and maybe to correct a bad habit with your use of the whip. It has to be a good thing.
Tim Easterby's multiple winner Thornton Gate, winning at Haydock last month. He is one of 45 winners to benefit from Lorcan's style this season.
It must be a great benefit to jockeys that have not been riding a finish for a long time because of the cold spell.
Without a doubt, Skew. I mean, especially in view of the last 5 or 6 days when we've had little or no racing, I'm sure this machine here today will get plenty of use. A lot of lads are going to use it to warm up before they actually go and compete.
Jockeys don't have to fall off to hurt themselves. From this performance, Lorcan's in danger of injuring his neck from looking around too much.
I'm slipping off!
Yes, do you know, they're all little boys at heart. I can confide in you. They were so thrilled with that they practiced on it all afternoon, and one jockey actually broke it. They had to get the vet in to put it back together again. So, after the news, you'll be coming back for the two real cracking chases we've got on. The Comet Chase sees Sound Man, who is a very exciting two-miler. And then, of course, we've got the Reynoldstown, which brings together all these very good staying novice chasers. Northern Lad is just one of them, St. Melian's Fairway, another one. So all of that to come after you've been away to the news. Don't go away, will you? It's cracking racing. Over to Andrew Harvey.
Good afternoon. Unemployment's fallen to its lowest level for nearly 5 years. The seasonally adjusted total of people out of work and claiming benefit was just under 2,206,000 last month, down 29,000 compared with December. The fall was larger than expected. Labour has welcomed the fall, but it says that many of the new jobs are temporary or part-time. The government says the conditions are right for the economy to continue growing.
Growth slowed down last year, but not to the extent it did on the continent because of our underlying strength. It will pick up again this year. I think every economist agrees with my expectation that the end of 1996 will see us strong again. And the overall picture is very healthy indeed.
Senior police officers are to hold an emergency meeting to discuss security in the wake of Friday's IRA bomb in London's Docklands. Detectives and assistant chief constables from across the country will be briefed by anti-terrorist officers next week. They want to stress that it's not just London which is at risk from terrorists. The captain of a training ship which sank off the coast of Cornwall last year has been charged with manslaughter. Three volunteer crew members died when the 137-year-old ship, the Maria Assumpta, went down near Padstow in May. Mark Litchfield from Maidstone in Kent will appear before magistrates in April. The owner of a fairground at Porthcawl in South Wales has been fined £7,500 after an accident in which a 9-year-old boy died. Timothy Morgan was killed when a lighting gantry fell onto the park's water chute. Pat Evans, the owner of the fairground, admitted failing to carry out proper repair work to the ride. The former manager of Liverpool Football Club, Bob Paisley, has died at the age of 77 after a long illness. Bob Paisley took over from Bill Shankly in the mid-70s. He became the most successful manager in British football history, winning 6 Football League titles and 3 European Cup finals. And that's all for now. The next news is at 4:05.
Now the headlines in the southeast. 12 families have been evacuated from their Docklands homes because last week's bombing has seriously damaged them. The homes on the Barkentine estate have been found dangerous by surveyors. Families have been moved to a local hotel while Tower Hamlets Council looks for alternative accommodation. An investigation's underway after a fire swept through a block of flats in the capital. More than 200 people were led to safety after the blaze at Blue Anchor Lane in Bermondsey. The building's roof was completely destroyed and residents had to be cared for at nearby community centres. It's not thought the fire was started deliberately. Unemployment in the region is still falling, according to the seasonally adjusted government figures released today. There were 686,200 people out of work and claiming benefit in the South East and Greater London last month. That's a fall of 9,500. And that's it. Now let's take a look at the weather prospects with David Lee.
Good afternoon. Well, some patchy cloud across the country at the moment. You can see that on our satellite picture across the Midlands and also across the far north of Scotland. That is producing some spots of rain, as is the cloud across the Midlands, some very light showers. The rain in northern Scotland being brought on this moist southwesterly wind, but further south, those cold northeasterlies dying away. And that means that for tonight, whilst in the north it'll be cloudy, we'll gradually find the frosty conditions which form in the north overnight pushing their way southward. So by the end of the night, in fact, the frost will be confined probably south of the Mersey to the Humber, lowest temperatures about -4 degrees. Moving on to Thursday, a frosty start across England and Wales, but the cloud in the north very gradually pushing its way south, but most of the rain confined to the northern parts of Scotland. And that's your forecast for now.
There is no greater love in all the world, it's true. No greater love than what I feel for you.
A feast for car lovers. Top Gear returns tomorrow, 8:30 on BBC Two.
Back now to Richard Pitten for more racing from Ascot on BBC Two.
And welcome back here to Ascot with the best races still to come. And just a footnote from that last race, Hills have made the winner seeking cash 7-2 favourite for the Stayers Hurdle, and that was from 20-1. Wasn't he impressive? Well, in our next race, Sound Man, who's come over from Ireland, has really caught everybody's eye. You couldn't fail to like him. Very exciting horse. And he'll be ridden by Richard Dunwoody, who was voted by the readers of the Racing Post to have put up the riding performance of the year. And this wasn't just jumping, this was flat as well. And the horse that he did it on was Unguided Missile here at Ascot. He was most impressive. Now, just have a look at him as he's just biding his time here in second place, but the horse almost goes down here. The saddle slips over, the weight of Richard's body slips over, but now you can physically see him actually pushing the saddle back by putting all the weight in his offside iron. Still, he's not happy. He tries again and gets it right, slap down the shoulder on Unguided Missile, and he gets back his equilibrium. Rough Quest is just in behind him. That's the one that he really fights out a duel with later on. But this horse, who does jump well, really benefited from Dunwoody. Now watch at the last. There, his nose hits the ground, he loses a length, and yet Dunwoody quietly gets back in rhythm and really gets down to it and rides the horse out to beat Rough Quest in a thrilling finish. Well, that's Richard Dunwoody at his very best. And it was good enough to earn him the title from the Racing Post for their ride of the season. And there'll be another one later on when the Leicesters, that's the Jockey's Own Awards evening, I should think he'll feature very highly in that one. Well, we've just time to catch up with a couple of outstanding results. Graham Rock.
Thank you. And Sedgefield, the 240 race. First number four, Once More for Luck at 4-1. Second number seven, Sudden Spin, 5-1. And third number 10, Shining Edge at 6-1. The totes there win £3.80, places £1.80, £2 and £2.10. And the dual forecast there, £16, straight forecast £25.15, the tricast £112.6. Wolverhampton 2.25, first number 2 Premier Dance, the 3-1 joint favourite, second number 1 Nordic Sun 16-1, and third number 7 Comtex Legend at 9-2. Totes win £2.70, places £1.10, £1.90, £1.30, the dual forecast £42.60.
Well, if you like seeing horses jumping fences at speed, Ascot's the place, isn't it? Down that hill, they really do leap. Well, let's catch up with the runners and riders for the Comet with Jim McGrath.
And we should have some good jumping here, Richard. Number one is Coulton, ridden by Jamie Osborne, in great form today. Number two is Easy Buck, Chris Maud. Three, Sound Man, who's bidding for his fifth win straight this season, Richard Dunwoody in the saddle. Number four is Sprouston Boy, Billy Worthington, and five, Storm Alert, Adrian Maguire. So all five to go here for this Grade One Comet Chase.
And as expected, Sourman is the odds-on favourite at 1-2. Coulton is 7-2 from 3. Storm Alert drifting out sharply there, 5-1 from 7-2. Easy Buck is 12 from 10, now 14-1. And Sprouston Boy, 66, the outsider of 5.
1-2 favourite, very relaxed in the paddock. Richard Dunwoody on board. Well, we've already seen him here, and he was most impressive. We'll pick up the action. He's upsides the grey Morsley. Morsley actually falls here, real pearly, just dives at it. But Sound Man then went on to win very easily indeed from Dancing Paddy. Morsley, I think, was a beaten horse at the time. Woody just eases him back. He pops up. There was some doubt about the way this horse jumped early on because he sort of doesn't really arch in the air, doesn't have a great trajectory. But he's a fast leaper of fences and a horse of the highest ability. Just got in a little bit close to that one, but the rest were absolutely nowhere. Sound Man came home alone with Woody looking round for non-existent dangers. So there is Sound Man. Let's get the expert opinion of it's the parade. We'll join Norman and Skew.
It's nice to be called experts by Richard Pittman. And then, anyway, the horse in front in the yellow colours there is Coulton, mount of Jamie Osborne, trained by Oliver Sherwood. Looked like being a top-class horse. Was very impressive on his debut of the season at Wincanton. Favourite for the Mackeson Gold Cup. Slightly disappointing since, but a very high-class horse on his day and is the one that could take Sandman along in the early stages.
Yes, good. They've worked wonders with this horse's jumping. He wasn't very good. Now he's jumping really well, and I'm sure he'd bounce out and try and take Sandman on.
There's number two, Easy Buck, the mount of Chris Maud. Lucky winner, we saw him on television when he was got the benefit of Morcelli's fall at Haydock, but another horse that'll be up there early on. There's the favourite, the great sound man. Is he good enough to take on the very best at Cheltenham next month? We'll see today. I suppose the only question mark about it is, will he stay the 2.5? I can ask that, Norman, in a minute. Sproutstown boy, former top-class hurdler, probably making up the numbers today. Michael Chapman and Billy Worthington have a lot of runners around here, but there's good prize money here to be had, £52,000 estimated value. And David Nicholson's horse, Storm Alert, is another one that could benefit from the horses going a real breakneck speed early on. Just a question mark whether he'll stay the 2.5. He was second to Sandman at Sandown. Can he improve today? So the question, Norman, is there a hole in Sandman?
I never really liked a horse. He carries his head a bit high and you think he doesn't jump that well, whereas actually now he does jump very well. He's proved this season, he's proved he's very, very good. Today I think, for me, he'll probably win again. It's whether he's up to winning a Queen Mother is another question.
Yeah, he's a fine looking horse, isn't he?
He is. I'm not sure he'd be the nicest of rides. He does carry his head high, but Richard gets on great with him, and Richard has been very impressed with him so far.
He's by Kimal. I can't think of any other Kimal horses that have been as good over this distance. I can think of Ryman Reason, who was a real stayer. It's unusual to see a horse as quick as this by style like him. There is Coulton, another horse that doesn't look an easy ride.
He's not an easy ride, but Jamie has worked wonders with him, really. He said to me one day that he thinks he's better off going to fences, closing his eyes and letting it up to him. But he really has, and he's now jumping very well. He ran a great race in the King George at Sandown. He was travelling better than anything, really, going to the pond fence, and didn't seem to get the trip, but he's back today to what I think is probably his best trip, and he's sure to go a hell of a gallop, and he could be the one to take Sandman on.
I'd just be a question mark over the ground with him, and I know he's probably won on it, but his best, he always looks the type of horse that would appreciate better ground.
He does, and the ground probably would help his jumping. The only thing is, he won at the Cheltenham Festival and it was pretty tacky.
Yeah. Yes, there's this is Storm Alert there in the blue and yellow, the red cap. The typical half clip of David Nicholson. I think the one chance with this horse is if they do go a right gallop in front, take each other on, Adrian will be sat in a little bit behind, hoping the others tie up a little bit. So often we see horses that look to have a turn of foot, and it's not so much them having a turn of foot as the horses in front stopping. I've always thought this looked like a horse that could go on and make the highest grade, and I suppose it's been slightly disappointing.
Slightly disappointing, you see, he fell last time, but he does jump well in the hole. I would hope that's what Adrian was probably hoping for, is that they will stop a little in front. But again, he's off levels with Soundman today, and it's hard to see him reverse the form of Sandown. I don't think he's a really top-class horse. For me, he's a pretty good handicapper.
Edward O'Grady, it's been reported, I listened to him on Radio 5 this morning, saying that Soundman would probably improve a little bit from this run. They've been held up with the snow. They're obviously preparing him for the two-mile champion chase. That, again, gives these horses a little bit of a chance that he's not quite at his best.
He probably isn't quite at his best, Soundman, but I've been in Ireland quite a bit, and I don't think they'd have been held up as we were in England.
Yeah.
And Mr. O'Grady, he probably wouldn't tell you a lot anyway. I'm sure he wouldn't send him over to Ascot if he didn't think he'd win.
Yeah. And there is Easy Buck. As I say, he was a lucky winner, I thought, behind Morcelli. Morcelli would look like being beaten by Soundman when he fell round here, so you can't really see it give the horse a lot of chance on that form. But as I said before, there's £52,000 at stake here. If you don't take these horses on, you've got no chance.
Yes, I see your yard skew does this quite often, really, just to run and have a go, and often it works. This horse I've won on myself, actually, before he joined you. He is a great jumper, and if anything happens, he'd be banged there with a chance. He gallops and jumps.
I suppose this applies here to Sproutstown Boy, Billy Worthington, a good, hard-working jockey.
He is, and he rides well. He's having a bit of luck this season with a good handicap hurdler non-vintage. This fella, it's hard to fancy him, but again, he's there. You have $2,500 for four prize money. Hopefully he'll get some of it.
Yes, I remember he's so old that he was actually going round when I was riding. I remember when Paul Kellaway had him, and he won a decent hurdle, handicap hurdle at Sandown. But so often these horses, good hurdlers, it's difficult for them when they're a little bit small jumping fences.
I have to check his age, Skew. He can't really be that old, can he?
And some and steady there at 1-2. Coulton, having gone out to 4-1, is just clipped back there, 7-2. Storm Alert easy out to 11-2 from 7-2. Easy Buck 16. Sproston Boy 100. Make a line
then. Try then.
And away they go in the Common Chase of 96, and on the right of the picture, the yellow sleeves of Storm Alert in the centre, Easy Buck on the left as Coulton and Soundman sitting in behind them at the first of 16, and Sproston Boy drops back to last. Well, Soundman tucked in behind in about fourth or fifth position as they head up now towards the second lane fence, and Coulton just went through the top of that but landed safely by two lengths to Easy Buck on the right of picture, with the armlets in behind them as Storm Alert, followed by Soundman and Sproston Boy as they come to the first of the ditches now, and all got over it safely. Well, the expected tussle for the early lead has not come at all, and it's Coulton by two lengths and under a tight rein as he goes to the fourth, from in second placing Easy Buck. In behind them on third position there is Storm Alert, followed by Soundman, held up behind in fourth, and Sproston Boy the outside is last of all as they race around the home turn the first time in this Comet Chase. Over 2.5 miles, they've got just on 2 miles to travel. Coulton just lobbing along there out in front by a length and a half. No opposition at all at this stage from Easy Buck on the outside of Storm Alert as they come to number five. Then in behind them is Soundman and a gap to Sproston Boy. Ambling their way up the home straight now towards the fence number six. It'll be the last next time round. And Coulton on the far side by a length and a half to in second placing Easy Buck, who's also under a tight hold. A length away then is Storm Alert, the leader just diving at that slightly, followed then by Soundman, who's second last, and four lengths away, Sproston Boy, who whips them in. Must be about 10 lengths off the pace as they've got a circuit remaining. The leader here is Coulton by three lengths, has been unchallenged throughout, from in second placing Easy Buck. A length and a half away then is Storm Alert, followed a similar distance further back then by Soundman, and a three lengths away, Sproston Boy, who whips them in as they turn sharply right-handed now and about to head down the side of the course. Good shot of Jamie Osborne on Coulton here. This leader just biding his time out in front, ambling along by about three lengths to in second placing Easy Buck. He'll be looking for challenges soon though as they head down towards fence number seven. A plain one coming up, and Coulton steadies at it, went through the top of it but got away with it. From Easy Buck in second as they head down the side and towards fence number eight, and it's Coulton still striding out nicely as he comes down now towards this fence number eight, and once again got in a fraction close from Storm Alert. Behind them is Easy Buck, Soundman, and a gap to Sproston Boy. Heading down towards the second ditch, which is number nine, and Coulton has a good lead here of three lengths over Easy Buck under a tight rein. In behind them is Storm Alert, the near side, Soundman over on the far side, the white cap, as they clear that one, a gap of four or five lengths to Sproston Boy. Heading down towards the water, number 10, and Coulton out in front by two or three lengths. To in second placing Easy Buck on the near side, the yellow sleeves of Storm Alert, from Soundman, a gap to Sproston Boy as they clear the water, and Sproston Boy just a little bit untidy at it at the rear of the field. Racing into Swinley Bottom now, and they've got short of seven furlongs to travel, and the leader here is Coulton by a length. On the outside, Easy Buck, half a length to Storm Alert. Now, Richard Dunwoody is starting to take Soundman up there in the centre, poised to challenge just behind these leaders as they come out of Swinley Bottom now and race up the side towards six out. And the leader here is still Coulton in the yellow jacket, from Easy Buck and Soundman over on the far side. Then Storm Alert behind them, and four or five lengths to Sproston Boy. Heading up now towards five out, Coulton's still the leader, but here come the challengers. Easy Buck on the far side. Oh, and he's gone, Coulton. He went right through the top of that. He didn't lift his leg at all, and he's crashed to the ground there, Coulton. That leaves Soundman on the outside of Easy Buck as they come to the last ditch. Four or five lengths then to Storm Alert, and a gap to Sproston Boy, and Jamie Osborne still on the floor.
Heading up now towards the third last, Sound Man, the red sleeves on the right of picture, and Easy Buck the left. They clear it together. Four or five lengths to Storm Alert, a long gap then to Sproulston Boy as they race up towards the home turn. It's Sound Man on the near side. He steals a peep over the shoulder, Dunwoody. He's going well. He's got Easy Buck covered, he reckons. Four or five lengths away then, Storm Alert, a gap to Sproulston Boy still continuing. Two to jump in the straight. Near side, Sound Man. He's about a neck up here on Easy Buck. He puts in a good leap at it. Easy Buck made a mistake. A gap then to Storm Alert, and further back is Sproulston Boy. One left to jump in the Comet, and Sound Man is clearing away. He's gone four lengths in front of Easy Buck now. A long gap then to Storm Alert. But coming up towards the last, Sound Man comes to it now, takes off, jumps at fuller style, and lands about six or eight in front, and coming away to win this in grand style. It's a procession in the run of the line, and Sound Man is going to win the Comet Chase by the best part of 10 lengths. Sound Man the winner, in second placing Easy Buck. A gap to Storm Alert in third, and a long gap then of about 100 yards to Sproulston Boy, who's the only other finisher. The winner there is number three, Sound Man, owned by David Lloyd, trained by Edward O'Grady, ridden by Richard Dunwoody, and ridden with the utmost confidence throughout. Second number two, Easy Buck, owned by JPM and JW Cook, trained by Nigel Twist and Davis, ridden by Chris Maud. And third number five, Storm Alert, owned by Mrs. Dawn Perrott, trained by David Nicholson, ridden by Adrian McGuire. And fourth, the only other finisher, number four, Sproulston Boy. And there is no change in the betting, Ladbroke's betting on the Queen Mother Champion Chase at Cheltenham. Sound Man still a 7-4 favourite. Strong Platinum at 9-4 and 3-1 Viking Flagship. But he sat in behind today, Sound Man. He didn't take on the leader at all, held up and always confidently ridden.
Yes, you're quite right, Jim. Always confidently ridden. It's all about split decisions, though, isn't it? Because if Richard had been tracking Coulton, which had been so easy to do, he'd have been brought down. But he did, obviously makes a few mistakes, Coulton, but this was a horrible, horrible fall. Jamie's asked for a long one. He hasn't got there. The ditches do catch you out a little bit there. I don't think the fall itself has affected Jamie as much as he's fallen right in front of Easy Buck, and Easy Buck has had no choice but to gallop all over him. But that really is a horrible fall.
Yes, Skew, it just shows you he's had two winners already today, and I'm sorry I put a kiss of death on him. I was saying about his jumping, how good it was earlier, but he couldn't have stood up what he did. He stepped straight in the middle, and let's hope Jamie's okay.
Yes, again, Richard's been a beautifully confident race here, eased him out. The more he sat on the Sound Man, the more he's come onto the bridle.
Yes, he's ridden it very handy his past couple of runs, but I think really he's going for the Queen Mother, and he just had to drop him in and teach him a little bit more today and get a lead. And any time he wanted him to pick up, he really travelled and got there. And your horse, Skew, has run a great race in second.
Yeah, it'd be interesting. Let's watch you saying that Sound Man isn't an easy ride, but let's watch how Richard Dunwoody rides into the fence here. The secret about horses like this is to keep going with them.
He always keeps going forward. Horses just, he's inclined to come back underneath him with his head up a bit, and if you were trying to help him, well, he'd probably walk straight into the bottom of the fence. And he just lets the horse go forward, and he jumps super with him. And I know Richard's a big fan of this horse, and he couldn't be more impressive than he was today.
When you say just keeps him going forward, I mean, not what you mean is not touch his head, not pull him. When you watch the show jumpers sometime, people, the show jumpers having to be much more accurate, are having to alter their stride going into it. Well, the jump jockeys can brush through their fences a little bit, and therefore don't need to alter the stride.
Yes, you can always. You ride some big horses, and you do have to just take hold of their head and get them back in their hocks a little. But horses like this, they seem clever. They're always looking at what they're doing. You can lie down and just get from one side to the other a little bit quicker than possible.
He could be going to Cheltenham with a great chance now. All these victories behind him, like a jockey, will give him great confidence. I think horses know when they won, and when they keep winning, they believe in themselves.
Yes, he had some very hard races last year, even at the festival. And it must be great confidence for a horse like him. He's done everything so easy this season. And I'm sure Mr. O'Grady is very looking forward to Cheltenham.
Yeah. And we can go to the SPs and Graham.
Sound Man, the winner there, 1-2 favourite. Second number two, Easy Buck, 16-1. Third, Storm Alert at 6-1. The totes there win £1.50 and places 1.10, 3.30. Dual forecast £4.30, and the straight forecast £7.58. And from Lingfield in the 250. First number four, Fool's Errand at 12-1. Second number one, Big Strand, the 6-4 favourite. And third number two, Chief Rager, 7-4. totes 920, places 180, 170, 110, dual forecast 960, the straight forecast 2768. And Wolverhampton 255, first number 2, Old Provence, the 3-1, second number 7, Kaimen, 9-2, and third number 4, Fox Chapel, 25-1. Totes there win £5.10, places 120, 120 again, 580, the dual forecast £9, the straight forecast £16.54.
Yes, with me down here in the winner's enclosure, the part owner of Sandman, David Lloyd. David, you must have been delighted with that run after the horse's break.
Absolutely, I was a bit nervous because obviously he hadn't run for a long time. I had apparently a lot of Christmas lunch and wasn't quite as fit as maybe we had hoped, but he was fantastic. And it's a little bit like Queen's Club, this one, for the Wimbledon coming up at Cheltenham, but it was great to win, and Richard again rode him superbly, and great horse. I mean, it's luck to have a horse like this.
And interesting that he's pretty good at distances more than 2 miles. I mean, this is virtually 2.5 today.
I think he's got a lot left in him, to be quite honest. And you know, I'm in partnership with the three other chaps who are fantastic, and it's great because I meet them again, you know, which is fine. And it's nearly the same as playing tennis, to be quite honest. The adrenaline there, and you see him go over the last fence and think, don't fall now, and it's great. I've enjoyed every minute.
But when you were playing as a tennis player, you can go and do something about it. Now you're just watching from the sidelines here. How difficult is that, watching your horse, when you can't go out there and be involved in it?
The only trouble is I'm too fat and too heavy to actually get on the horse and actually see if I can do it, so I wouldn't try that, and I'll leave that to the experts. But it is quite frustrating to not know quite what's going on. But when you've got someone like Richard on a horse like Salman, you've got the best too, so you know, normally you're going to get the good results.
Sounds as though this racing bug is biting quite deep.
Yeah, I love it. It's great. It doesn't quite match up to playing Davis Cup, but it's not far off. The adrenaline really goes, and it's been tremendous.
I hope the English team haven't got a game during Cheltenham week.
I'll cancel the match. I mean, the Davis Cup now has to be put. No, it isn't actually. It's in May, so we're okay. We can watch it and then go off to the Davis Cup in May in Newcastle. So it's been terrific.
Will you be down at the festival for the 3 days?
I'm going to go for the first 2 days, yeah, and hopefully, if it wins, maybe I won't get up until the next morning. Too late. So no, it's. Last year it lost just by a very short head in the Arkle. Even though it lost, it was such a fantastic race. You couldn't be disappointed in the way, because everything, you know, those two horses, the Clarion Davison, coming up the last like that, it's just like a head-to-head tennis match. It's just tremendous.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, that's exactly what it is, tremendous. And well done to Edward O'Grady. He's always been in the top flight of trainers. Norman Williamson's come back out to join me. We were just discussing Jamie Osborne's fall there. It didn't look nice at all, I'm afraid, and he's still receiving medical attention down there. We will update you as and when we hear the result from the doctors there. Well, as we said earlier on, Norman Williamson is sitting here with me because, of course, he's dislocated his shoulder. And that was in the Tote Gold Trophy on Saturday. Well, it may have been a great race and a great result for Paul Carberry, but for poor Norman here, he won't want to see this one again. So look for Norman. He's riding Eskimo Nell there in the yellow colours, going to the cross hurdle, and the horse actually dives at it, snatches, look, and powers him into the ground, and Pridwell behind him there goes over the top. Norman's left out of the game on only his second ride back.
Coming down towards the home turn, Romanza still has the advantage on the inside. Express Gift towards the left on the outside. Just in behind them come Non Vintage. Just in behind Non Vintage, and still very much in contention. Just behind them is Clifton Beat, who's made good progress. And Squire Silk also, and over on the far side, Nijmegen is not out of it. That was the third last. And it's Romanza with the advantage from on the near side, Express Gift. Squire Silk comes next. Pridwell's been pulled up. Nijmegen over on the far side. Romanza from Squire Silk now as they come down towards the second last. Romanza on the near side, Squire Silk, Clifton Beat not far off them. Nijmegen over on the far side. That was the second last flight, racing towards the final one now, and it's Romanza being pressed by Clifton Beat on the near side, Squire Silk on the far side. Coming down towards the final flight, it's Squire Silk on the far side, who's just taken a fractional advantage from Romanza. Then comes just in behind them Clifton Beat, over the final flight, and it's Squire Silk from Romancer, a furlong to run now, and Squire Silk from Romancer, then Clifton Beat, and then Nijmegen and Non-Vintage and Celibate finishing well, but Squire Silk is still holding Romancer as they race up towards the line. He's getting very tired, Squire Silk, but he's just going to hold Romancer as they come to the line. Squire Silk has won the Tote Gold Trophy, second is Romancer, third is Non-Vintage.
Well, Norman, that was a good result, but you wouldn't have seen that where you were, will you?
No, I wouldn't have seen it. I only saw it for the first time today, and quite frightening.
Yeah. But going back to the Ford, do you remember much about it?
Yes, I remember just off the bend. I was travelling well and decided just to make a little bit of ground up going down to the hurdle. And you can see here now, she's a little filly, so I just take hold of her head and try to get her back on her hocks a bit, downhill hurdle. And as I'm getting her back on her hocks, up she comes out of my hands, and really had no chance from there on.
Did Pridwell touch you?
Yes, Pridwell kicked me here. The minute I hit the ground, I thought, I'm okay, and next thing, bang, I get it. But I don't really know where I dislocated my shoulder. It might have been just the impact of the ground, and looking at that, it probably was. I hit the ground pretty hard.
You have done it before, Norman. Is this a weakness or not?
Last time they said it could be a weakness and it'll happen again, but from then on there was really no problem with it, and they thought, okay, it probably won't pop out again. But now there would have to be a doubt of a weakness, and I'm giving it a go to hopefully get back for Cheltenham, but after that, hopefully it doesn't pop out again, and during the summer I'll go and have an operation on it.
I often say, you're all mad, you jump jockeys. I don't know why you do it. I mean, but last year you had 130 winners, a tremendous season, Gold Cup champion hurdle, and then this, I mean, you could barely have had a handful of rides.
Yes, it's amazing. It just shows you. I had a season last season which nothing could go wrong. Any fall I got, I was up straight away, and this year it's not going right at all. But hopefully if we get back, we just have to keep trying to get back and get back fit. It's a very thin line between mad and stupid and everything like that. Is brave doesn't come into it, I think.
Okay. Well, also on the same day as the Tote Gold Trophy, there was another fascinating race, and in it we saw Viking Flagship come right back to the top of his form.
Trovado on the bit now as they come down to the final ditch now. And Valfine has dropped out of it, and Trovado has taken it up from Viking Flagship, and it's these two, the old rivals, Trovado and Viking Flagship, coming down to the second last, and they land in unison, racing towards the final fence now. And Spree Cross has gone at that one, coming down to the final fence in the Mitsubishi Shogun Game Spirit Chase, and it's between Trovado and the near side, Viking Flagship on the far side. Viking Flagship lands in the lead from Trovado. Nakia jumped it third. It's Viking Flagship with the advantage over on the far side. Trovado trying to peg him back towards the near side, but Viking Flagship is going to win his 19th race and his 39th attempt. The old hero, he's won it. Viking Flagship, Trovado is second, his old rival.
Yes, well, that was most impressive, wasn't it? The horse, his great quality is the ability to fight and pull out a bit more, isn't it?
Yes, he's one of them real top-class horses, really. I was second to him in the Queen Mother and Deep Sensation last year, and second to him again in Aintree with that super race. But he, for me this season, it took him a couple of runs to come right. I thought he ran a great race in Wincanton behind Dublin Flyer over a long trip. And Adrian said on Saturday, he said he went to the last fence and he couldn't see a stride, and last stride just went go on and up he springed and gave the fence 2 feet, you know. But he really is a top class, and sound man is good, but he's a tough nut, and this will crack. He's, you know, if he comes back to his best in Cheltenham, he's very good.
Yeah, indeed he is. Well, the fall that Norman had on Eskimo Nell, it was only his second ride back after breaking his leg and being off most of the season, and it precluded him from riding Master Oats in the Irish Hennessy. This was won by Imperial Call.
Six from home now, another ditch in Imperial Call, the leader. Over from Life for Lord Michel Acure, Master Oates, a five-length gap to Flashing Steel, who's cleared of Lotion and Son of War, and Nuaf tailed off. They're going now to the fifth from home, and it's Imperial Call, the leader. From Life of a Lord on the outside is Michel Le Curé, and they're followed on the inside by Master Oates. They're clear of Flashing Steel as they go now towards the fourth last in the Hennessy Cognac Gold Cup, and it's Imperial Call, the leader. Michel Le Curé in second, Master Oates third, Life of a Lord has dropped to fourth. Four from home now, Imperial Call, the leader, from Michel Le Curé and Master Oates, then Life of a Lord. They're clear of Flashing Steel, a mistake. And they're followed by Son of War as they go towards the last ditch. Three fences from home, Imperial Call and Conor O'Dwyer. From Master Oates, the Cheltenham Gold Cup winner of last year, in second and closing the gap. Michel Lecure is third. At the final ditch, Imperial Call over from Master Oates in second. Michel Lecure, Life of a Lord, and they're clear of Son of War, Flashing Steel out of it, and then Lotion. Down to the second last now, Imperial Call and Conrad Wire. They've made all. They've a three-length advantage over Master Oates, Jamie Osborne in second. Then Michel Lecure, Life of a Lord, trying to get back into it in fourth. But two from home. It's Imperial Call from Master Oates. Imperial Call over from Master Oates. Michel Lecure landed a bit flat-footed. They race to the home turn, and Imperial Call, the seven-year-old, in the lead, having made all the running. Master Oates and Michel Lecure, the two English raiders, in pursuit. Life of a Lord is back and forth, but as they race now to the final fence in the Hennessy Cognac Gold Cup, it's Imperial Call, the leader, chased by Master Oates and Michel Lecure. It is still a long run to the line as they come to the final fence. Imperial Call out in front from Master Oates. Imperial Call is over. He makes his first mistake, but he survived it. Master Oates is in second. Michel Lecure is in third. And racing into the closing stage is Imperial Call, finding plenty. Master Oates in second and racing up to the line. Imperial Call getting a great reception from the crowd. He's sprinting to the line, Imperial Call. Just one error at the final fence, but this is a smashing performance from the young horse. Imperial Call wins it for Fergie Sutherland. Second is Master Oates, three Michel Lecure. Back in fourth place is Son of War. Behind Son of War in fifth is Lotion.
Now, Norman, Master Oates, although he was beaten, he was not disgraced, and that was a good run.
It was, I thought, a very good run on the day. He has improved from Sandown, and I think he'll improve again. He's back, and they're very happy with him. They say he came back looking great. And really, Cheltenham, it's hard to see him turn tables with the likes of Imperial Call in one man. But you have an extra quarter of a mile, you have a big hill in Cheltenham, heavy ground, he just might be able to do it.
Yeah. Was there still any explanation why he pulled up at Chepstow, that amazing first run?
Yeah, we still, nobody knows. It's just one of them things, I think you'll have to forget about it. It just shows you that they're not machines, I think.
Yeah. Imperial Call, though, does look a machine, doesn't he? I mean, he was good enough to beat good two-milers, and now going up in trip, he's very good here.
Yeah, he's very, very impressive. He really looked to me like the Irish one man because of the way he travelled. He travelled, jumped. You can't really take away from what he did. Very difficult to pick holes in it. He made a mistake at the last fin, still picked up and quickened. Mm. And the Irish lost Mary Gill. It's good for him to have a horse like this coming through.
Absolutely. Well, news coming in from Jamie Osborne is that they don't think anything's broken. They're going to take him away to be x-rayed, precautionary x-rays. He hadn't regained consciousness the last time that we heard, but let's hope that he does very soon. So, Jamie, being taken off for x-rays, we wish him well. Well, that Comet Chase was, as we expected, a clear-cut win for the favourite. He stamped himself, as we knew, to be a very, very good horse. Well, we move on to the Reynoldstown. Fascinating this, because it's for novices. We can take the runners and riders from Jim McGrath.
Number one is Mr Mulligan, Richard Johnson. Two, Major Summit, Philip Hyde. Three, Sommelian Fairway, Adrian Maguire. Four, Bond Jr., Tony McCoy. Five, Go Ballistic, Michael Fitzgerald. Number six is Lord Galeen, Richard Dunwoody. Seven is Northern Lad, Warren Marston. Number eight, Peatswood, Andy Thornton. Nine is To the Woods, Carl Llewellyn. And 10, Ubuvel, A.D. Smith. So all 10 to go here in this Reynoldstown Novices Chase. And it promises to even upstage the Sun Alliance Chase at Cheltenham, that's for sure. Here's the betting.
And favourite at 9-4 is St. Melian Fairway. 3-1, Mr. Mulligan. All that money up and down the country for him this morning. 7-2, Northern Lad. 13-2, Major Summit. 10-1, Go Ballistic. Then 14-1, Ubuval. 16, Bond Jr. He was backed each way this morning. 16, Lord Galeen. 16, To the Woods. 50-1, Pete's Wood.
It looks a four-horse race, and here is one of the major players. It's Northern Lad. Jenny Pittman trains. He was a decent hurdler, but now that he's gone to fences, he really has looked something special. Well, he was most impressive at Haydock Park. On this occasion, he jumped brilliantly, and he beats Billy Goat Grub from David Nicholson's yard, and that horse has come out and won since, really franking the form. But although there was a very little between these two, the rest of them, well, were just left as if they were walking. Now, the two of them really get down to it, and Northern Lad goes for it and every time he's asked for an effort, he picks up and goes more. Now, Billy Goat Gruff is a decent horse, but this was a good performance from both the winner and the second, and the further they went, then the further he was starting to draw away. Staying is his forte, and he jumps very well indeed. Northern Lad going out very much on his toes, and that's just one of the horses that will come under the scrutiny of Skew and Norman Williamson.
Yes, Richard, I hate to disagree with you because you're always right, but I just wondered, that was a more of a workmanlike performance than a great performance, and if there is going to be a Sun Alliance winner here today, we're probably going to have to see a real good performance. It's not always a good pointer towards the Sun Alliance here. We see lots of, I remember seeing one man get beaten here, but Billy Groat Gruff was having his first run over fences then, and I thought for two out looked a real danger, but Nathan Ladd was giving him £6 and really galloped on towards the line.
Yes, and David Nicholson here has, you know, with Billy Goat Gruff, he's got a great, he shouldn't really know which one is the best, and he's taking him on with St. Mellon Fairway, so I'm sure he'll have to improve a little bit to go and win this.
It's a difficult start here, isn't it? You can just see the downhill there, Norman. We said it's a good hurdle race track, but it is a pretty fearsome is the wrong way. It's a well-respected steeplechase track, especially for these novices with a downhill start to start with.
It is. You just have to ride it, I think, with a little bit of sense down over the first two or three fences. You've got to go your own pace, whether it's fast or slow. There's no point in putting a horse on top of his head down the hill. That first fence there, it's claimed a lot of them in the past, and I'm sure it will in the future.
That's right. It's the horses fall there through silly mistakes rather than a serious blunder, don't they?
Yes, and I think a lot of jockeys are told be handy, and there's not a lot you can do if you are, and you just get a little bit too much pace on and land out in your head and buckle over.
Yeah, I find it's, when there's a whole lot trying to be handy, it's hard to find that good position early on. Anyway, we'll get on and have a look at the runners, see the rest of them. And here is a serious contender, I suppose, for this Sun Alliance, Mr Mulligan. I've watched him a lot of his runs. I saw him win over at Uttoxeter, first time over hurdles, and he was impressive at with Weatherby last time. He's ridden by Richard Johnson, who I think is a quite superb young rider, and you would know this horse better than most because he was in your yard at one stage.
Yes, he actually rolled over on top of me one day in Newbury, but last season when Mr Bailey had him, he was very, very weak and ran at Newbury. He made a lot of mistakes that day, but I turned down the back straight, looked behind, and I couldn't believe I was probably 20 lengths clear. He's a great cruising speed. He jumped well in Weatherby. I think he's strengthened up a lot, and it'll be interesting to see how he jumps today, I think, because he's a horse, big long striding horse, and he just might have to shorten in one or two of these fences, which he didn't do in Weatherby. He was just galloping and jumping from wherever he met the fences. But Richard Johnson having a great season.
Yes, he's 5-2 joint favourite. I agree totally with what you say there. You can see, I couldn't see him in live, just looking at television. He looks a big angular sort, and he will struggle, I think. He's not really been taken on over a fence, and just going down that hill, he may be today.
He may be today, especially early on, I think. We often find a lot of these horses, you say they're not being taken on, a lot of the reason is they're not good enough to
exactly,
take them on.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
This filly, he'll just have to organise himself, I think, today.
Yes, and here's a big talking horse entered in the Gold Cup, St Mellion Fairway, a horse they're talking, say that likes the soft ground. I haven't seen a lot of him myself. Have you watched him?
Yes, I've seen him run his boat actually at Linkfield, and he was impressive, very heavy ground. He beat a nice horse of ours in Betty's Boy, and he's just another horse again over these first couple of fences. He was inclined to rush at Linkfield, and I was speaking to Adrian earlier, and he said he was hoping that he would just settle a bit, but a better race today, I'm sure he won't have a problem. Actually, this is probably the best ground he's ran on over fences. It's soft, but it would be better than Linkfield. They're definitely hoping that he is very good.
He's 9-4, 5-2 joint favourite from 9-4. And, there's another horse that's unbeaten over fences, Major Summit. He's a horse that hasn't gone and won a long distance by a long way, but he's a horse I like very much, and I know his trainer Josh Gifford holds him in high regard.
Yes, he has jumped well, and Sandown, I saw him win at Sandown, he only just got up to win, but he looks a very tough horse, and here with the likes of Mr Mulligan going off in front, and this fella, you could just see him there with every chance of turning in.
And a change of favourite here at Ascot. Mr Mulligan is now the clear favourite at 9-4, having opened on the course at 3-1. St Millian Fairway has just eased a fraction 5-2 from 9-4, 4-1 Northern Lad from 7-2, 8-1, bar those three.
There's a horse that's travelled a long way from the north, number 10, Ubu Val, a real out-and-out stare. Won at Folkestone last time. Another one that won't mind the ground.
Won't mind the ground, and pretty safe jumper. I think he'll just have to improve a little bit, with whether he's up to this class. But I'm sure he'll give Eddie Smith a good ride.
He's 16-1 from 14-1. There's a horse that you could give a real chance to, Go Ballistic. He was second here last time. He looked like winning going to the last to me, but Hilliff Tuller really battled on, giving him £7 that day. He's had his odd wind problems, and that may just have caught him the last bit of the race. And again, if they go a good gallop, it could catch him again.
Yes, Mick Fitzgerald gave him a fabulous ride here last time. He arrived at the right time, and Hilliff Tuller just made a mistake, and he probably ended up being in front sooner than he wanted to be. Again, at Newbury, he was absolutely running away one day at Newbury when he fell. And things just really haven't gone his way, but I think he's a horse with a lot of ability. He's a great traveller through his race, and that might help him around here.
And what a good betting race this is. Now joint favourites again, Mr Mulligan and St Millian Fairway, both 5-2, Northern Lad 4-1, 8-1 bar.
Number 9 to the woods, and the horse, as you will say, well, I know a lot about. He's a horse that hasn't run over this distance before. We're hoping that stepping up to the 3 mile from the 2 mile. He enjoyed the trip. He liked the soft ground. He jumps fairly well, but I don't want to tempt Providence.
I was speaking to Carl earlier, Skew, and he was hoping to trip had helped this horse a lot.
There's a horse I don't think I would be swapping places for, Pete's Wood. She's a fairly decent, or he's a fairly decent horse, but trained by Mick Shannon. But the two F's on his name to go around in a big race like this would make me very nervous.
Yes, Skew, I think I'll stay here. Andrew Tone, who was in Kelso yesterday, and he's down here today. I'm quite warm where I am.
I'll let you pronounce this one, Norman. The Mount of Richard and Woody, owned by Stan Clark, a New Zealand bred horse. Stan Clark's had some very, very good horses. I won a Sun Alliance for him on Rolling Ball. He's got Lord Relic, another New Zealand horse, and it's quite a tall order for him.
It is. It's a lot to ask of a horse first time, but he's got the man on board, and we've got a gem.
You hang on, hang on.
Coming in now, the clear favourite, Mr Mulligan now. Great tussle they've had for favouritism. St Millian Fairway, 5-2. That's it, they're away in this Reynoldstown Novices Chase over 3 miles and half a furlong and charging down towards the first of 20. Mr Mulligan on the far side has cleared it first, and they're all over the first. Okay, a mistake at the rear of the field there by To the Woods as they charge down towards the second. Mr Mulligan it is who shows the way from on the near side, Ubu Bell. St Millian Fairway, Ubu Bell made a mistake on the near side. Bond Jr. is right up there, and so too is Major Summit as they continue their journey down towards fence number 3. And this is an open ditch coming up, and Mr Mulligan is who's tearing off in the lead by 2 lengths to Major Summit as they clear that one. In third is Bond Jr. back in the field. Lord Galeen hit that one very hard. Up in about fourth position, St Millian Fairway, the outside, Ubu Bell there in the pink jacket on the near side as they head now towards the water. It's Mr Mulligan who shows the way, clears it well from Major Summit. Owen Bond Jr. just slipped on the landing side there and dropped back a place, passed by St Millian Fairway. Lord Galeen getting up on the inside there of Go Ballistic as they race now into Swinley Bottom. Further back in the field then is Lord Galeen on the inside from Northern Lad, a gap to Peatswood and To the Woods is at the rear of the field. The leader here is Mr Mulligan, coming out of Swinley Bottom the first time. The big white face, very prominent there in the centre of the screen, leads by 4 or 5 lengths as he clears number 5 in grand style from Major Summit in the yellow jacket. 2 or 3 away then in third placing, St Millian Fairway, the white cap, followed by Ubu Bell, then follows Bond Jr. And he took a little bit of a guess at that one, the leader. Got away with it okay, and they've all cleared it well. Heading up now towards the second of the ditches, which is number 7, and it's Mr Mulligan who comes to it now, just brushes through the top of it by 4 or 5 lengths to in second placing. is Major Summit. Sumelian Fairway in third from Ubu Vell on the left and the Pink Jacket. Then Bond Jr. from Go Ballistic Northern Lad. Further back is To the Woods in company there with Lord Galeen as they clear that one. And Peatswood is last of all as they race up now towards the home turn the first time in this Reynoldstown Novices Chase. And they've got 2 miles to travel. And so far, Mr. Mulligan, Richard Johnston has made every yard, leads by 4 or 5 lengths to in second placing Major Summit. In third is Sumelian Fairway with the white cap the outside. Then on the outside, next in about fourth position, as they clear that one is Bond Jr., that was number 9. Further back is Ubu Vell, the inside from Northern Lad. Then Go Ballistic behind them as they travel up the home straight. Lord Galeen is further back, followed by To the Woods and a gap to Peatswood. Heading now towards number 10, and it's Mr. Mulligan who comes to it now. He steadies. He just brushed through the top of that one once again, but got away with it. Lands about 4 or 5 lengths in front of Major Summit. 3 away then in third is Sumelian Fairway, followed by Northern Lad. Next in the field then, Lord Galeen is starting to make a place or two with Bond Jr. Out wide to Go Ballistic. 2 lengths away, Ubu Vell, followed next by To the Woods and 4 or 5. And then to Peatswood, who whips them in as they charge past the judge now, swinging right-handed and racing down the side of the course once more. Back where they started, and Mr. Mulligan, Richard Johnson, out in front there. He's striding out nicely. He's made every yard of the running so far, and he charges down now to what will be fence number 11, and he's a good 5-6 lengths in front of Major Summit. He comes to it now, Mr. Mulligan. He steadies. He has a good look. He takes off, and he jumps it well from Major Summit in second. Then in third is Northern Lad, followed by Sumelian Fairway. Next on the in the centre is Lord Galeen, running a good race from Bond Jr. A gap to Go Ballistic from Ubu Vell. Further back is To the Woods as they come to the next one. The leader cleared it well. Further back in the field, Ubu Vell, followed by To the Woods, and Peatswood is tailed almost off. As they head down now towards the next of the ditches, this is number 13, and Mr. Mulligan out in front, leads comfortably by a good 4 or 5 lengths. As he draws to it now, he took off and landed over it in the lead from Sumelian Fairway, then Major Summit behind them, followed by Lord Galeen, then Northern Lad the outside, and further back is Bond Jr., and Peatswood has refused at the rear of the field. Heading down now towards the water, the final time, and Mr. Mulligan, he's set a hectic pace throughout. Now they're starting to chase, leads by 4 lengths, 2 in second placing Sumelian Fairway. Then Major Summit the outside, 3 away then is Northern Lad, Bond Jr. the outside, Lord Galeen's called it a day, dropping back now, and about to be passed on the outside by Go Ballistic. As they race out of Swinley Bottom now, and they've got 6 fences left to jump in the Reynoldstown Chase. And the leader here is Mr. Mulligan. He's just riding out nicely. Leads by a comfortable 4 lengths as he comes to 6 out now. He takes off. Once again, he brushed through the top of it. Slight mistake by Major Summit in third placing. But it's still Mr. Mulligan. He's pulled the stick on that Sumelian Fairway in second from Major Summit as they come to the next one now. Mr. Mulligan again brushed through it. So too did Major Summit. Slight mistake there by Bond Jr. back in the field. Coming now towards the last of the ditches, and this is 4 out, and coming to it, that's Mr. Mulligan putting an extravagant link there, lands about 4 or 5, 6 lengths in front now of Sumelian Fairway. Further back then is Major Summit from Northern Ladder, gap to Go Ballistic, 3 out, and it's Mr. Mulligan. He's getting a bit weary, went through the top of that, brushed through it, but got away with it once again. Lands 8 lengths in front of Major Summit, who's running on well. Then follows Northern Ladder on the near side as they round the home turn with 2 fences left to jump in the Reynoldstown, and Mr. Mulligan has gone further ahead. He's 15 lengths in front with 2 to jump. Mr. Mulligan straightens up. He's a street in front as he comes towards the second last now. Mr. Mulligan takes off, jumps it okay, getting a bit tired, but he's still 12 lengths in front of Major Summit, followed by Northern Lad. Sumelian Fairway has fallen and brought down Go Ballistic. Coming up towards the last, though, and it's Mr. Mulligan who has literally run them off their legs. He's only got to jump the last to win. He's 10 lengths in front. He steadies coming to it, takes off, lands safely, and Mr. Mulligan is home for all money. Going into second placing, then Northern Lad, followed by Major Summit, but up the line, Mr. Mulligan has made every yard to win the Reynoldstown Novices Chase. A great win, goes on to win by the best part of 12 lengths. In second placing, Northern Lad, third then Major Summit. Going to be a good battle for fourth here. Ubu Vell flashing home on the far side might just get up to take fourth. Just ahead there of Lord Galeen, further back To the Woods. And they're the only finishers. Looking back down the track there, just walking between jumps there is Bond Jr. who's been pulled up. The winner is Mr. Mulligan, a 9-4 favourite. Backed in from threes, a lot of confident money, and he has carried that confidence to victory. his fifth consecutive win of the season. Owned by Mr. M. Worcester, trained by Noel Chance, ridden by Richard Johnson, the winner number one, Mr. Mulligan. Second is number seven, Northern Lad, owned by Jay Shaw, trained by Jenny Pittman, ridden by Warren Marston. Third, number two, Major Summit, owned by A.D. Weller, trained by Josh Gifford, ridden by Philip Hyde. And Ubu Valet might be, who just got up to take fourth right on the line. But the winner from Lord Galeen. But the winner there on the screen is Mr. Mulligan. He now gets a quote of 7-4 favourite from Ladbrokes for the Sun Alliance Chase at Cheltenham from 7-1. And he has today attacked those fences and done it in dashing style.
Yes, and here's they come to the second last here. He's well clear. Richard Johnson doesn't really need to do much now.
No, Skew, he's given him a great ride. He's such a big horse. He didn't try to alter him too much. There was a few fences he got a little bit low at. We can see St. Mellon Fairway there and Adrian turning over and bringing down Mick Fitzgerald and Go Ballistic. Adrian, I think, really was a matter of time till he went. He didn't jump well at all. But the horse in front, you can't take anything away from him. We were saying that his jumping might be folded, but the way he's jumped today and galloped, it's going to take a good horse to take him on.
Yes, it's... You said the reason that not many have tested his jumping, because you can see why not many are good enough to get upside him. I did make a mistake earlier. I said that one man got beaten this race. In fact, one man won this race and then got beaten in the Sun Alliance novice chase. As I say, it's not always a very good guide for the Sun Alliance, but surely this is as good a horse as I've seen win this race since one man, at any rate.
Yes, very. He really is very impressive. He just keeps galloping in it all the way down the back. He had everything unconscious behind him, and... you know, he can't take anything away from that.
No, he does just go and brush through one or two of his fences. They're pretty stiff through here. He seems to know what he's doing. He just wouldn't want to be doing that at one of the ditches up the hill at Cheltenham.
He wouldn't, and he lands out in his head a little at one or two. But he does seem to know what he's doing.
And we go to the SBs and Graham.
And Mr. Mulligan lands the gamble of the day, 9-4 favourite. Second number seven, Nathan Northern Lad, 4-1. Third number two, Major Summit at 8-1. All 10 ran. And at Lingfield in the 320 there, first number three, Ticket is Gift at 5-1. Second number 10, Prince Nasher, 10-1. Third number 14, Do Beware, 25-1. And fourth number four, Old Hillwood, 14-1. The totes win £6.60, places 180, 670, £3 and £3.50. Sedfield, the 3-10 race, first number 6, Go Silly, 4-1. Second number 2, Call the Shots, 4-1. And third number 8, Over the Corrib, 14-1. The wind topes there, 350, places 110, 230 and 360. And finally, at Wolverhampton, the 3:30 race, first number 2, Nikita Starr at 14-1. Second number 3, Nan Shan, the 3-1 on favourite. And third number 4, Highlights at 33-1. The tote, £13.90 for a win, £4.80 a place. And Nanshana plays £1.
Yes, down here in the winner's enclosure with me, Noel Chance, the trainer of Mr. Mulligan. And my goodness, that was a fine performance because, of course, he was giving weight to all the others.
Absolutely, it was a very good performance. He was giving upwards of £7 to some of the others. Civilian Fairway, Major Summit, he was giving those £3. You know, it was a very meritorious performance.
Some very good horses have won this and, of course, gone on to win that staying novice chase at Cheltenham. That is your next target. Would he run in between?
No. No, it's unfortunately it's since 1973 no horse has won it, so we might be able to lay that to rest, you know. But that's his next run.
And this horse has just progressed and gone on all season, and he goes off at such a gallop. Well, is he like that at home?
Well, we can't work another horse with him because he kills him. You know, I remember working a horse with him when I came here first. That had won two races, and it came up a half a furlong behind, and I was depressed. You know, but now I realise, you know, it was something. We were taking on something, you know.
But today, watching the race, it was apparent from a mile out that he had them all stone cold.
Oh yeah, a mile out, they were all. It was only a matter of standing up, you know.
You're a man who's been involved with a few good horses. How does this lad compare?
Well, this is the best. Unfortunately, I haven't been involved with enough good horses, but this is a good horse, you know. Probably we don't know really how good he is, you know. Like, that's a mini Sun Alliance, you know, there. And you'd have to be thinking of perhaps next year a Gold Cup horse, you know, if he stayed all right.
And an Irishman going to Cheltenham with a major chance. This would be a warm favourite now. How would you cope with that?
No problem. You know, that's no problem. You can get used to winning, you know.
Noel, it's good to see you and the horse like this. I hope very much that he wins for you.
Thank you.
Yes, you can get used to winning, can't you? What an impressive galloping performance that was. Well, it's hard to think of it, but in 4 months' time, it will be the Royal Meeting here. And if you wish information on tickets for that meeting, because you can buy them in advance, you can ring this ticket information line. It's on 01344 876 456. So that's normal telephone rates apply for that if you want to come here for the Royal Meeting. Well, just casting our memories back and then forward, on Saturday, of course, we'll be at Chepstow, and in part of Grandstand's coverage, we'll be bringing you Denoli's next run from Gorham Park in the Red Mills Hurdle. That will be a cracker. Well, the whole of Ireland held its breath when he made his reappearance in a very impressive one in the Irish Champion Hurdle.
Down to the final flight now, and it's Hotel Manella the leader. Hotel Manella from Collier Bay, Denoli in third and racing up towards the line. Hotel Manella, Collier Bay, Denoli trying his hard out in third and racing up towards the finish. Hotel Manella, Collier Bay, the far side, Collier Bay and Hotel Manella, Denoli in third. Collier Bay wins it, Hotel Manella, and Denoli's what a blinder.
Yes, Denoli being welcomed there by Tom Foley and Tommy Tracy on board. It was a tremendous run, and what a great reception from the Irish racing crowd. Now, he'll be running, as we say, on Saturday, and we'll bring it part of our coverage on Saturday. And looking further ahead, even the Grand National. Of course, the weights came out last week, and that has caused a flurry in the betting market. To update us, Graham Rock.
Yes, thank you very much, Richard. As you know, the Grand National 6 weeks now on Saturday, and the weights were published in London last week, and immediately the bookmakers put up their prices. They also put up one or two fancy bets as well, like how many will finish or will Jenny Pittman train the winner. But these are the latest prices: 16 to 1 Deep Bramble and Young Hustler, 20 Low Stragoni, Master Oates, Monsieur Le Cure, Rough Quest, Smith's Band and Superior Finish, 25 to 1 Bar. And the best backed in the last couple of days, Low Stragoni okay. And Young Hustler.
Well, interesting betting there, and there's also fun bets on it, and you can do spread betting on where horses finish, you know. I've taken a little bit on Young Hustler to finish better than 13th. Now, if he gets round, that's got to be a bit of fun for me, hasn't it? I'm just hedging my bets. Of course, if he falls again or unseats his rider, then I'm up a gum tree. Still, I've been there before. Now, what a tremendous day we have had here. The racing has been of the highest degree, of course, but bad luck on Jamie Osborne there, and we haven't heard back from the hospital as to his latest state. But when he left here, as I reiterate, they were taking him away to x-ray him as a precaution, but he was unconscious at the time. Well, the Comet saw Soundman put up the performance we thought he'd put up. A very fast jumper, beautifully ridden by Richard Dunwoody. Skew and Norman were explaining how Dunwoody gets down into a horse when he goes to a fence, and it really is superb. He really has an empathy with horses, and when your heart's on the right side of the fence, it's a marvellous thing. Do you see him patting the horse there? It's good to have a relationship with a horse, and the Woody just affording a little smile there, and again, a pat down the neck. That was a fine performance, and Edward O'Grady will be very pleased with it, there's no doubt. David Lloyd, of course, spoke to Jonathan Powell afterwards, and it really shone through his excitement at being involved with such a good horse. The Reynoldstown, well, I was just amazed. I thought that was going to develop into a real ring-ding battle. I thought there were four horses that were outstanding. In the end, the winner just absolutely floored them. He galloped from the front. Though he's a different colour, he reminded me very much of the late and much lamented Killiney, who went on to win at the Cheltenham Festival, the Sun Alliance, by 25 lengths. Do you think that this horse could do the same? He certainly looks very useful. Well, the season, we've lost a few meetings because of the weather, but happily we look to be back on track now for an uninterrupted run up to the Martel Grand National. Of course, in this race, there's so much of interest, and we'll bring it all to you. Well, I do hope that you've enjoyed your day here at Ascot. It was saved from last week when it was abandoned. I've enjoyed it, and I think the punters here have had a good day. So thanks for joining us. See you on Saturday. Goodbye.
Because of the racing, there was...